Okay, time to start. So I think my plan for the last two lectures changed a little bit. So I think I don't have time to talk about general theorems like Bondel-Orlov reconstruction theorem. So I'll just stay with talking about exceptional collections on projective spaces. And I think the major goal will be to explain this transitivity of the action of the braid group in the case of P2. So I explained that there is a general action of braid group on the set of exceptional collections, in a category, and then it's conjectured to be a transitive, well, up if you also kind of consider up to shifts. But it's only known in very few cases. And so I will try to explain main ideas of the proof in the case of P2. And if I have time, I'll mention some other cases when this is accessible. So one idea that goes into, well, it's actually useful not just for this, but for... it kind of is a natural idea when you think about for example, standard exceptional collection on projective space. Right, so we look at O of 1 of n. So we have seen already several proofs, or maybe at least one proof that it generates. So you can express every other sheaf on projective space, kind of taking various cons here. But actually, we even seen a more concrete proof what how to get all the other line bundles from here. And actually, so if you look at the this exceptional collection, look at the corresponding endomorphism algebra, right? So you look at the endomorphism algebra of this. So what you will get is some kind of truncation version of the symmetric algebra, right? So you'll have like home from OI to OJ is S G minus I of the n plus one dimensional vector space. But so you will only see this where J minus A is at most n. So here I and J are between 0 and n. So as an algebraist, you kind of can't help to feel sorry for the full symmetric algebra. And you really want to somehow recover the entire symmetric algebra in some way from some purely categorical construction. And so in this way, clearly what you want to do is somehow, is there a natural categorical way to recover the full symmetric algebra? And of course, we know the answer in this case. So what you need to do is somehow we need to extend, we need to look at the at the infinite collection. Where you just have all possible line bundles. But of course, this collection is not exceptional. So what will be true is that in this infinite collection, if you take any consecutive n plus one elements, they will form exceptional collection. But the symmetric algebra will be there. So now there will be no truncation. You will have when you look at the Homs, you'll get arbitrary high degree symmetric polynomials. So the question is. High degree polynomial. So the question is, what is there a categorical procedure which kind of does this for any exceptional collection. And the answer is yes. And so what you have to do is you start with any exceptional collection. So then what you can do is you can take, let's say, take object E0, and then you start mutating it. So you mutate it to the right through E1, then you mutate the result through E2. So I'll just write here R as the corresponding mutation operation. So you'll get, eventually you'll get to the right of En. So the object that you get here, so this is like what we're doing is we're mutating this collection, exceptional collection n times, every time mutating kind of what, so the object that was obtained from E0. So, and in the end, you'll get here R, so I'll just write Rn E0, meaning that I kind of applied this, so I took this E0 and I mutated it n times to the right. So, and so call this object En plus 1. And then you can repeat this procedure, so iterate this. And you get kind of infinite collection to the right. And also you can do the same to the kind of in the left direction, same, and do the same with left mutations. So you start with E0, En minus 1, En, and then you start mutating En to the left. And eventually, you'll get here an object Ln En. And this one you will call E minus 1. And again, iterate. And so in the case of Pn, I claim that you will get precisely the full collection of line bundles. So I will not do this exercise in general, but it will follow from what I will say next. So let me just give you a quick example for P1. So for P1, we just have O of 1. So if you want to mutate here O of 1 to the left, right, so you need to use the sequence. So V is two-dimensional vector space. This is projectization of V dual. So you have V tensor O goes to O of 1. And here you will have, so V is the dimension, is the space of morphisms from O to O of 1. So here you have left mutation of O of 1. And this is, of course, O of minus 1. Just by looking at ranks and determinants, you see that this is a line bundle, and this should be O of minus 1. So, and then when you repeat this, so you'll get here O of minus 2 and so forth. And because left mutations and right mutations are inverse of each other, so if you mutate O of minus 1 to the right through O of 1, if you mutate O of minus 1 through O, you'll get O of 1. And therefore, the same will happen when you mutate O through O of 1, because tensoring with O of 1 is an auto-equivalence of this category. So this means that I'll get off to and so forth. So here every two consecutive objects form a exceptional collection, and the same is true here. So in this collection, which is called the helix, associated with exceptional collection, if you take any consecutive n plus 1 elements, you'll get an exceptional collection, which is a mutation of the original one, kind of associated with the exceptional collection E not En. So the right. So there is a nice the reason these guys are useful is mainly because of the connection with serial duality, which you can already observe. So of course this was kind of maybe. Precisely how this relation was discovered, that you can notice that in the collection on PN, right? So if you take kind of just one step beyond, so if you take any n plus one consecutive elements, you'll get an exceptional collection. If you just go one step beyond this, so if you take two objects which are n plus one steps apart, then they're related by tensoring with the canonical bundle on PN. Right? So if I take O of 1 of N, so this is what is called the foundation of the helix. So this is a kind of full exceptional collection here. So then if I take one more object, so if I see how much apart are these, the, to get from here to here, you have to tensor with O of minus n minus 1, which is the canonical bundle of PN. And so the claim is that, which is, so this operation, this is not quite the surfunctor. So the surfunctor is tensoring with the canonical bundle and then shifted by n. So, so we get that to get from here to here, you have to apply surfunctor and then do some shift. And so the claim is that this is going to hold in general. And so here is the general result about this. So actually, the general result doesn't even mention surfunctor, but in fact, any, yeah, so. But it's equivalent to the statement. So assume we have that some triangulated category is generated by an exceptional collection. And so we have, so consider the object, so Ln En as before. So this means that we take En and mutate it through all the objects to the left of it. And so then here we'll get Ln En. So consider this object. So to get something resembling surfunctor, I actually shifted by N. So then the claim is that so for any object x, you have that home from En to x dual is isomorphic to home from x to ln En shifted by n. This is a functorial isomorphism in x. So, and of course, this is equivalent to saying that if I assume that there is a surfunctor on the category D, which is actually always true, so I'll comment on this later. So the surfunctor of En is equal to Ln En shifted by N. So this is precisely what was happening here. So if I take, I guess I apply this to this exceptional collection. So this will be my En, or n plus 1. So I move it n steps to the left. I get O. And then I shift by n. So O shifted by n is the result of applying surfunctor to O of n plus 1. Right. So the remark here is that any category generated by any triangulated category generated by an exceptional collection. Admits a surfunctor. So in fact, there is a more general result that if you have a semi-orthogonal decomposition, you have two, so these are admissible subcategories, and if A has a surfunctor and B has a surfunctor, then the entire category also has a surfunctor to exist. And so this is kind of believable. So the existence of surfunctor, it's always a question of admissibility, representability of some functors. So to see that some functor exists, so that this guy exists, you need to see that the functor is home from to any object dual and home from any object dual, that they have to be representable. That's kind of easy to see that this is equivalent condition. And right, so because one of them will represent, will kind of correspond to just surfunctor, and another will represent to, will correspond to the inverse of the surfunctor. So you need to show that something is a surfunctor, you also at the same time have to present the inverse functor. Right, so one of them will be represented by surfunctor, another by inverse surfunctor of X. And so you kind of have to use, so you start with some object, and then somehow you use, so it has a canonical triangle with some pieces in A and B, and so you use this triangle and some surfunctor in A and B. So it's actually not as simple as you would think. So you can try and do this, and you will probably fail, and then you look into Bondel-Kapranov's paper. Sorry, this is Bondel-Kapranov's paper. They have a paper on with surfunctors in the title, and so there you'll find the proof. Right. So actually, there is also one case. So if you're talking about strong exceptional collection, so for strong exceptional collection, and if the category, so maybe remark number two. So if we have a strong exceptional collection, then and in a category which is enhanced, then we know that the category will be of the form derived category of finite dimensional modules over some algebra of a directed quiver. So there is some. So it is enough to construct a surfunctor in this category, right? So we know that kind of if D is enhanced, then any strong exceptional collection in D will give this equivalence. So it is enough to see how to construct a surfunctor in this category of finite dimensional modules. So the why is it nice to have it to have the situation that's directed quiver? Because this algebra, it will be a finite dimensional, and it will also have finite homological dimension, and that's all you need. So in fact, if you have any finite dimensional algebra with finite homological dimension, then there is a construction of the surfunctor, which is in the exercise one of today's set, and then the surfunctor looks like this. So you use two kinds of dualities. So you have, first duality is, let's call it large D. So it's M goes to R home from M to A. So this goes from the derived category of right modules to the derived category of left modules. Yeah, I think, oh, yes, sorry. Unfortunately, I think in my exercise, I stated this for the left modules. But Yeah. You can just, yeah, it's the same. So, and there is a second kind of duality, which is just going to the, yeah, so this is like, this algebra is over some field K. Yeah, so finite dimensional and finite homological dimension. So the second functor is just duality over a field. So you just take, send every module to the dual vector space, and it also has a structure of a module, but on the other side. So if you start here with left modules, you'll end up with the right modules and vice versa. So now the claim is that the surfunctor is the composition. So surfunctor is d followed by delta. And this is just a kind of easy exercise in abstract algebra. You need to use the standard adjunction between tensor product and HOM. Okay, so right. So let me now go back to. So this was a remark. So on existence of surfunctors. So this general result. Now I can I can even give two proofs. But so let me prove this. So well, it's really maybe just the same. Thing, but so the let me give a proof without assuming the existence of a surfunctor for now. So right, so this ln en shifted by n, so this is a composition of n. So this, what is this functor? So kind of. So this functor is, you can think of it as follows. So we have this subcategory e naught through en minus 1, let's call this B. This is an admissible subcategory. And so what is happening here, I have some object in the left orthogonal of this, and then I mutate it to the left through each of the generating objects. So that's the same. Up to, so with correct shifts, this is the same as if you just mutated through this subcategory. So this was one of the things we stated maybe on Monday, that this is the same as actually mutation through the subcategory shifted by one. So that's so basically for this kind of compatibility, that to mutate through the subcategory is the same as to mutate through its blocks is. So here you need to replace the left mutation by left mutation shifted by one, and then you have exact compatibility. So here you n times apply left mutation shifted by one. Right, so the result is going to be, so this was, n was in, yeah, so LB here is this LB shifted by one, so this is the functor going from B left orthogonal, which is in this case is just spanned by en, to the B right orthogonal, which in this case is just spanned by one object. This well, let me just call it LB en shifted by one. We actually know that this is an equivalence. Right, and so. So by construction, we have an exact triangle. So we have en, and then we have some object in B. And then here we have this LB en shifted by 1. And so if you look at this, look at HOMs from en to this triangle, you immediately see that there will be unique morphism here because there is no HOM from en to b. So HOM from en gives an isomorphism. So it gives an isomorphism HOM from en to en with HOM from en to lb en shifted by 1. So, and so there will be no higher Homs, and this will be one-dimensional. So now, using this, we can construct the required, well, we can construct the pairing between these two. So we have a pairing between Homs. So I take Homs X to LBN shifted by 1 tensor Homs from EN to X. So this is just given by composition. I can compose these guys, and I get into Homs from EN to the mutation of EN. And we know that the last one is just K. So we got the pairing, and the claim is that this is non-degenerate, that it's a perfect pairing. And for this, you just need to observe So for this, you just need to do the following. So you start with arbitrary x, and then you have to consider left mutation of this x through b. So there will be some triangle of this kind. So there will be this will be object of b, and then here we'll have left mutation of x through b shifted by 1. So we have exact triangle, and no, the main point here is that this object will be, again, in B perb. And then if you consider Homs from EN to this triangle, because Homs to B from EN to B is 0, so you'll get that Homs EN X maybe into Homs from EN to left mutation of X is actually isomorphism. And similarly, if you consider Homs from this triangle to left mutation of EN, so you will see that, again, Homs from B to this is 0. So you'll see that Homs from LBX to this guy is isomorphic to Homs from X to this guy. So it means that so this pairing is kind of functorial. So what happens is that you see that the left-hand side of this pairing does not change when you replace X by left mutation of X through B. So the left-hand side does not change if replace X by left mutation of X through B. So it is enough to see that this pairing is perfect when the object here is in the right orthogonal to B. So, this LB, so enough to consider, so enough to prove that pairing is perfect when X is in B perp. But this B perp is actually generated by one single exceptional object, left mutation of EN. And so all you need to do is to check that when you put here this object itself, then this will be perfect pairing. But in this case, this will be one-dimensional space, and this will be one-dimensional space, and this pairing will just reduce to this arrow, which is an isomorphism. So in this case, it's clear. So enough to consider the case when x is equal to left mutation of En. And in this case, the pairing just becomes an identity map between one-dimensional spaces. So this proves this general result. So before I show some applications of this idea to consider helixes, I want to also show how this result gives a way to check. So it leads to the following construction of the so-called dual exceptional correction. So there is right, well, actually, there is two of them, right and left. So let me just consider right dual collection. So given an exceptional collection U not En, so what is, then there is a certain right dual collection to it, which I will call F not Fn. It's constructed as follows. So you write your collection E0, E1, 2, En. And then you do the following. So you leave E0, so you don't change E0. And then you move E1 to the left. And then you move E2 through everything to the left. And then and you continue doing this, so you will mutate En through everything to the left. Okay, so the rule is simply, so you fix the left end of the collection, and then you move every object to the left, through everything to the left of this object. Okay, so if you have just three, yeah, and then you call this collection F not through Fn. So if you just have three objects, so then the dual collection will be kind of L square E2, L E1, E0. So you mutate E1 to the left once, you mutate E2 to the left twice, and then you put them like this. Yes, so you mutate this through this, mutate this through this. And I think in the previous exercise set, you can try to calculate this in two examples, one for P2 and another for another is for some for representations of A3 quiver. So why is it called dual? So the point is that when you look at the morphisms from the objects of the original collection to the objects of the new collections, so you will kind of have so they will behave somewhat like dual bases. So there will be like from E0, there will be of course mapped to En to Fn, but not to all others, which is clear by semi orthogonality. So from E0 there will be unique morphism to Fn in degree zero. Then from E1, there will be unique morphism to Fn minus 1 of degree 1. So this will be, it will really be from E1 to Fn minus 1 shifted by 1. And there will be no morphisms from E1 to all other objects of the collection. So the main property of this construction is that this is kind of dual basis. So home from from Ej to F. So if I put here star, so meaning that I consider homes to all possible shifts of another object, and I view them as graded spaces. So then, right, so then this is going to be 0, so it will be k, so it will be a kind of one-dimensional in degree n minus I when j equals n minus I, and 0 otherwise. Right, so maybe in this example, right, so this is f naught, f1, f2. So there will be a home from E0 to E0 to F2. Yes, so this is because they're just the same objects. So it will be a home 1 here, and it will be home 2 here. And there will be no other morphisms from these objects to these objects. So this actually immediately follows from this isomorphism. So the main property is the following. So it's enough to check this. For I equals 1, for I equals 0. So it's enough to check that when you consider home from Ej to F0, then you get this answer. Indeed, because so when you consider so homes to some other, so you take some object here and you consider morphisms from various objects of E to this guy. So there are two cases. Either you're considering morphisms so this morphism plays the same role as F0, but for this smaller collection. Right? So it's kind of leftmost in this part of the dual collection, and it's actually obtained by just taking like this smaller set and doing the dual to this. Right? So then from everything to the right, there are no homes to here because it still lies in the subcategory generated by this part of the original collection. And by same orthogonality, there are no homes from any of these objects to here. So you only need to check to control homes from this part to here. So you can always assume that you're working with the leftmost object of the new collection. So, but then I apply this, so this F0, this is precisely ln En. And so, therefore, we can use this formula. So it tells us that if you try to calculate this, so you take as x various shifts of, so x will be Ej shifted by something. And then you apply this formula, and so this will correspond to dual of the space from home from En to Ej. And by same orthogonality, this is going to be 0 unless j equals n. And so when j equals n, we know what happens also. So this gives the proof. All right, so let me now give a more interesting application of the helixes, and this is I will now specialize to the case of PM. So maybe this actually for the rest of my talks, I will only consider this. Specialize to derived category of coherent sheaves on Pn. And later I will even specialize to the case n equals 2. But So what is special about this case? So what is special here is the following, that there is this compatibility between the length of the exceptional objects, the exceptional collection that generates it, namely m plus 1, and the shift that appears in the surfunctor. This shift is n. So actually, this a lot of what I'm going to say would also be true for any variety for which the derived category of coherent shifts is generated by dimension plus 1 objects. So somehow this connection with the surfunctor, so you know, when you get this connection, and this n here is the length of the collection, whereas the n appearing in the surfunctor is a dimension. So when they two match, this means that when I start from a sheaf en, then this ln en is again a sheaf. Okay, so this is what happens. So suppose I have any. So suppose yeah. So first of all, maybe first remark is that so we know that the derived category of coherent sheaf. We know one collection here, which is of length n plus 1. So I claim that this implies that if you have any full exceptional collection, it also has length n plus 1. So this implies that any full exceptional collection on derived category of coherent sheaves on PN has length, consists of n plus 1 objects. So this is for the following reason, that whenever you have full exceptional collection, then you get a basis in the Grothendieck group of your category. So let me remind you the following. So you probably heard about Grothendieck groups for abelian categories. So they're defined in the same way for triangulated categories. You just replace the short exact sequences of objects by exact triangles of a triangulated category. So it's you start with a so it's abelian group with generators which are formal symbols corresponding to objects, and then whenever you have an exact triangle. Whenever you have exact triangle, you put y equals x plus z. So I think this automatically implies that the shift gives you minus 1. I think if we apply this to the standard triangle, first of all, if you apply it to this part of the triangle, you get that the class of 0 is 0. And secondly, if you apply it to this part of the triangle, you'll get that the class of x of 1 is minus the class of x. So if your triangulated category is a derived category of is a bounded derived category of some abelian category, then this group actually is isomorphic to the it's easy to see, it's isomorphic to the Grothendieck group of the corresponding abelian category. So if you have any object, so it has bounded finite number of cohomologies, so you just replace this object by alternating some of the classes of cohomology in the abelian group of the in the Grothendieck group of the abelian category. This gives you map back, and it's easy to see its isomorphism. Right. So now, so this it's quite clear from this that if some objects generate triangulated categories, generate a category as a triangulated category, so they generate everything by taking columns, then from this relation it's clear that the corresponding classes generate generate the growth index group. So there's a furthermore. So the claim is that if you have a full exceptional collection, so then in fact the classes of these objects form a basis in the group of in the K-naught group. The group is denoted as K-naught of the category. Well, it's clear that they span, so clear that they span, and you can prove that they form a basis in a several ways. Well, you can use so whenever you have exact functor between categories, between triangulated categories, then it induces induces a homomorphism between the growth index groups. So therefore you can use here the adjoint functors to pieces of semi-orthogonal. So in fact there is a stronger statement that whenever you have a semi-orthogonal decomposition, so then you have you actually have a direct sum decomposition of K-naught of D into K-naught of A plus K-naught of B. And the point is that you have inclusion functors here, but you also have the adjoint functors to the embedding. And so the compositions of those are identities. So on the level of K-groups, this gives you homomorphism like this, and then kind of retractions back. So you get that... you get this semi-orthogonal decomposition. So, this direct sum decomposition. Now, another way to see that they're linearly independent is also to use the natural bilinear form that we have. So, so in this category, for every two objects, there will be finite dimensional graded homes. So you can associate with every to object, you consider, so if you have two classes, x, y, you can define a bilinear form by setting, this is sum over I minus 1 to the I, dimension of home from x to y shifted by I. So using the exact long exact sequences associated with triangles, you can see that this descends. So you need to check that in each argument, these relations kind of it's compatible with these relations. And this follows from the long exact sequences of associated with triangles. So then with respect to this form, this basis is going to be semi-orthogonal. So because there are no homes from right to left, so therefore, okay, so the basis E1, En in the growth index group is going to be semi-orthogonal with respect to the bilinear form, which is usually called Euler form, yeah, because this alternating sum looks like some kind of Euler characteristic. This is Euler bilinear form. So semi-orthogonal with respect to chi. So this is because when I is bigger than j, then we have home from ei to ej is 0. So we get that chi from the corresponding basis, between the corresponding basis elements is also zero. And also, due to the fact that each of them is exceptional, we have that chi from EI to EI is one. So using this fact, you can give another proof that they're linearly independent. So the matrix of the form with respect to this basis is going to be strictly upper triangular with ones on the diagonal. So this can only happen when they are linearly independent. So this also proves that the number of objects in any full exceptional collection is just the rank of the Grothendieck group. So if the category is generated by some exceptional collection, then the K naught of this category is isomorphic to free abelian group with number of elements equal to n. So this n is an invariant. It doesn't matter which collection you choose. So now given an exceptional collection on Pn, so it has to have n plus one objects in it. So if I extend it to helix, right? So the helix will have the property that EI equals to the nth left mutation of EI plus m plus 1. And but now we use our connection with the surfunctor, right? And we see that EI shifted by n. So this is going to be nth mutation of em plus 1 shifted by n. So this is going to be the same as the surfunctor on Pn applied to ei plus m plus 1. But we know what is the surfunctor, right? So this is the ei n plus 1 tensored with omega, which is O of minus n minus 1, and then shifted by n. And so this is finally the cancellation I was talking about, the coincidence I was talking about. So this n cancels with this n. And so we see that the same thing as in the collection of all line bundles happens, that we simply have. So we simply have that EI equals EI plus m plus 1 tensored with omega of Pn. So this is just EI plus m plus 1 shifted by minus I minus 1. So equivalently, you can just say that EI plus m plus 1 equals EI shifted by m plus 1. So the same property that we have for the standard exceptional collection. So now we claim that it holds for any, you start with any exceptional, full exceptional collection on Pn and extend it to helix, and then you get this property. So this is, let's see, do I have time? Yeah, I probably have time to prove this. So this is proper, this can be used to prove the following theorem. So this is due to Bondel. Let me say that definition. So let's say that an exceptional collection is pure on Pn, is pure if every EI is a sheaf. not just is a sheaf in degree zero. So these are objects in derived category. So this is exceptional collection in odd through EN. So all of these should be sheaves. So R sheaves. So for example, the original collection consists of sheaves, and conjecturally, actually, everyone is pure, but up to some shifts. But this is not known. So the first part of the theorem is that if you have a pure, if a full exceptional collection is pure, then any mutation of this collection is also pure. So it continues to be a sheaf. So in particular, this applies to the standard collection and already gives a non-trivial fact that if you start with a standard collection, start mutating in any way you like apply any element of the braid group, you'll still get only sheaves. So you'll get still just pure collection. And secondly, if you have a pure exceptional collection, then it's strong. So strong means that there are no higher X, only HOMs between morphisms, as morphisms between the objects. So I'll just sketch the proof in the remaining several minutes. So the proof is actually very simple. So yeah, because we're talking about sheaves, about property being pure, so it's convenient to have this notation d less than or equal than 0 and d bigger than or equal than 0. So these are subcategories in the derived category of coherent sheaves. So the same subcategories you can define in any derived category of abelian category. So this is the subcategory of complexes such that they're, so if you consider the sheaf cohomology in degree, so the sheaf cohomology should be all concentrated in this region. They should be all only in degrees 0, minus 1, and so forth. So there will be no sheaf cohomology for I bigger than 0. And for this category, it will be no sheaf cohomology for I less than 0. And so something is a sheaf is precise, so something is pure, so it's precisely when it's in the intersection of these two. So this will be a kind of abelian category sitting inside its derived category. Yeah, so S complexes with cohomology only in degree 0. Because if a complex has cohomology only in degree 0, it's actually quasi-isomorphic to the complex which actually has 0 terms at other places. This is easy to check. So, right, so now the proof of the theorem. So for one, you first observe that when you mutate to the left, so if we start with some object of our category, of our exceptional collection, mutated to the left, maybe actually it's already convenient here to consider just a helix. So we consider the helix first. So just the full consider a helix associated with this exceptional collection. By this property, it consists entirely of sheaves. So that's the most important observation. So it consists of sheaves because of this connection with the surfunctor. So so now when I say mutate, I just take some place in this helix, and I start mutating object to the left or to the right. So that's what I mean. So take some object of the helix and mutate to the left. So the claim is that we always get something, get an object of d bigger than or equal than 0. So this should just follow from the defining triangles. So the defining triangles will be, so you have some, say, you mutate EI through I minus 1. So you have here some maybe home EI minus 1 to EI, tensor EI, and then here you have your EI. And then here it will be left mutation. So you see that this object is going to, yeah, so the one to the left is EI of minus 1. So this object is going to sit between this and this. And so you just need to check that both of those are in d bigger than or equal than 0 by a long exact sequence of cohomology. And so it continues to hold like this. So if the original object, so if it doesn't, it's not EI, but some object in d bigger than or equal than 0, shift by minus 1 actually corresponds to translation to the right. So it's still in d bigger than or equal than 0. And here, the morphisms also will be in correct degrees, so that this will be in d bigger than or equal than 0. So on the other hand, when you mutate to the, so kind of dual observation is that when you mutate to the right, so if mutate to the right, so we get an object of d less than or equal than 0. So now, so let's write this full full helix. So we have this helix. So suppose now I want to check that when I mutate E0, E0 to the right, then maybe several times, then I get still something pure. Well, the point is that this, for example, I mutated to the right once. This is the same as if you first mutated to the right n times and get n plus 1, and then you mutated back n times to the left, right? Because the right mutations and left mutations for this orthogonal guys, they're the same. So this means that the right mutation of E naught is the same as n minus, you take n plus 1 and mutate it n minus 1 times to the left. So now, from the previous observations, one of these sides is going to be in d less than or equal than 0, and another side will be in d bigger than or equal than 0. So therefore, it's actually in both, therefore it's pure. Okay, so and so yeah, I'll tell you the proof of the second part next time. All right, so now we have exercises, but I think also David wants to say something. Hello, David.
So I'm David Eisenbud. I'm the director of the institute, and I'm really glad to have you all here. I've been away, or I would have welcomed you at the beginning. I guess Alain Barcelot did that. So you know all about the institute, and by now you're old timers here. So you've had a good time. I hope you've had a good time mathematically and otherwise in Berkeley. At least it's cool compared with many parts of the country. Great subject, and I hope you profit from this experience. Anyway, I wanted to say hello and see you.